Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is Redberry Rio here, and welcome back to my Civil Air Patrol videos. Now, in today's video, I am going to talk a little bit about specialty tracks. And some of you might be like, what are those? Now, specialty tracks are the different paths that you can take as a senior member in Civil Air Patrol. And whether you're a cadet who is potentially eventually going to be a senior member, or someone who is planning on being a senior member or is currently a senior member, this video might be a good resource for you. Now, there is some documentation that talks about the different specialty tracks, like specialty track guides and just general regulations listing them out and what each of them does and their functions. And I'm going to be talking about most of these briefly. So stay tuned for some very exciting information. There are 22 total specialty tracks. And when you think about it, the cadet side, they get leadership tests, they get tests on aerospace education, health and fitness related stuff, drill and ceremonies, it's all great. It's all good. And then on the senior member side, there's this 22 different specialty tracks. Now, as a cadet, you might serve in different cadet staff positions, serving in some of the sub functions underneath specialty tracks under senior member mentorship, because each senior member can serve as a mentor to a cadet. However, like, it's just, you don't like specialize in one thing when you're a cadet. Like, you don't specialize in public affairs, for example, or you don't specialize in communications. You just have a general overall cadet experience that most cadets should have, but then the senior member side is a little bit different from that. So I'm gonna list all of the different specialty tracks off and talk about each of them a little bit in depth, but one thing to keep in mind when you are thinking about specialty tracks is, what do you want to get out of Civil Air Patrol? What kind of experience are you anticipating? And is there anything in particular that you are interested in, like hobbies or personal passions, that Civil Air Patrol might have available for you? If you think about those things, then you can typically find a specialty track that will really jive with your interests and you will enjoy. But if you get ringed into something that you don't want to do, communicate that with your leadership in the squadron and try to come to a resolution. Like, I know when I first became a senior member, I was told, these are all of the empty positions, or all the positions that we need support in the squadron. Can you pick a few to maybe help fill in, because we need to meet certain requirements as a unit to pass our squadron unit inspection by having people in these staff positions? And I was like, yes, but that's because I have experience in a lot of the functions that I'm serving in. Like, I'm an emergency services officer, and I have qualifications within emergency services, so that makes sense for me to serve as the emergency services officer. But if you're a brand new senior member and you have never served in Civil Air Patrol before and you're completely unfamiliar with the environment, pick one or two specialty tracks that you really want to focus in on and find the staff positions that are associated with them. And that will help you feel more interested and engaged in the program. Because if you're doing something that you don't want to do, like, let's say you don't want to do administration, you don't want to do the paperwork for people, and you don't want to make sure that the permission slips and the forms are all filled out properly and filed correctly, like, if that isn't your jive, then don't do administration. Say, that sounds interesting, but it isn't something that I am passionate about, and I would prefer to support the squadron in another function. And then they'll help try to find something new for you. I know I said I was gonna list off the different specialty tracks, and I will. Just a moment, I just wanted to put that out there. Find what you're interested in, know what your expectations of Civil Air Patrol are, and try to best work those things together to make sure you are getting the most out of your experience, and it's a positive experience that you enjoy. Here are the 22 different specialty tracks. Personnel. Public affairs, finance, inspector general, professional development, administration, logistics, operations, standardization, evaluation, Emergency services, communication, aerospace education, cadet programs, safety, legal, health services, chaplain, command, historian, moral leadership slash character development, recruiting and retention, and information technology. That's a ton of different specialty tracks. And again, I suggest finding one or two, if you're first joining, that you're really interested in. So let's go over each of these things and figure out what they mean and if it's a good fit for you. Now, personnel is the first one, and that's just kind of keeping track of the records. So when people are signing into a meeting, the personnel team of the squadron would be making sure that everyone is signing in, and it's ensuring that everyone is accounted for. So personnel officers help with assigning duty assignments. They help with awards and decorations that are being given to members. They help with membership applications and making sure fingerprinting is done correctly. And they also enable the squadron to effectively function as that really important support role. And I know I listed off those things, and it's actually in a pamphlet called Cap Pamphlet 200, which is the specialty track guide, which is used for the track. And there are three different levels within each track, which I want to go over before I move on to the next part, because retention lasts longer from the beginning of the video. So let me mention the different levels in specialty tracks. You first start with no rating, and you're like assigned to a duty position. So let's say for personnel, you're assigned to the personnel duty assignment within the squadron, and you serve in that for a few months, you complete all the training, then you get to the technician level. Upon completing all the requirements for technician, you move into senior, and then after senior, probably a year or so later, you'll be able to get master. There is nothing after the master level. It's just that it takes several years to complete each specialty track, and you can do several simultaneously. You can't just do one at a time, but if you're feeling overwhelmed by the sheer number of requirements for specialty tracks, it's okay to just focus on one and then progress in that, and then maybe add on additional responsibilities as you're more comfortable. But the personnel officer helps to make sure that duty assignments are in, and duty assignments are what positions you might be serving in within the unit. So if you are an aerospace education officer, or if you're an emergency services officer, communications or logistics, then they would make sure that that is put into e-services. And everything has to be put into e-services in order to meet the requirements for specialty track levels. So I'm just saying, if it's not in e-services, then you won't be able to progress. So just be familiar with what progress you are making. Check your personnel file to make sure that your training is being added in. So, moving back to the specialty tracks, public affairs is the next one. And that is the one that is important for the visibility of the squadron. So, social media pages, making sure that pictures meet the required regulations and that uniforms are correctly made. And also just sharing general information with local newspapers, stuff like that. Those are the responsibilities of the public affairs officer, and they are kind of showing that public image of Civil Air Patrol to the local community. So for example, recently, 3 years ago, we were wearing BDUs and we were required to take the American flag patch off of the BDUs. Now, in photos, from there on forward, we were required to double check through the photos to make sure that American flag patches weren't being worn by the members in those photos. And that's because in the regulations it stated, you can't be wearing this anymore. And the uniforms have to meet those regulations. Now, if the insignia, like the little metal pieces on the collars, are a little bit off, that's okay. But if people are missing name tapes or like ribbons are falling off, stuff like that, the public affairs officer has to make sure that it's presenting a very positive and professional public image of Civil Air Patrol to the community and just wearing the uniform proudly in all instances that it's being presented. The next one is finance, and it's all about the money. So helping put together the budget for the unit, helping with fundraising, keeping track of everything, and keeping the commander updated on these expenditures and any donations that might be coming into the organization. Inspector General are the people who, well, they investigate specific cases involving complaints about Civil Air Patrol. So these are official complaints. So if there was a case of sexual harassment, then the IG would be investigating that potentially on behalf of the wing commander, for example. So it's a very serious position, and there are very few of them typically. Professional development is essentially what I am doing right now, because the professional development officer needs to explain to members in general the training opportunities and make sure that everyone is progressing in whatever capacity that they are interested in. So I serve as a professional development officer in my unit, and I frequently check in with the members about once a month, if not more frequently. It depends on the senior member and how actively involved they are. But I try to make sure that everyone kind of understands the next steps that they need in order to finish the level that they are working on and the specialty tracks they are working on. I haven't really talked about levels within Civil Air Patrol yet for senior members, and I'm planning on doing a separate video on that because I'm primarily talking about specialty tracks here, and I want to keep those things separate. So stay tuned for more information on levels, but as a professional development officer, I'm helping ensure the success of senior members within the squadron as they are achieving their goals and being involved with the different things that they would like to be involved with. Administration is all about the paperwork, and that's all I'm gonna say about it. Logistics is keeping track of anything that the squadron owns. So that might include uniforms. That might include color guard equipment, or like a guidon that the unit might have. Or there might be a box with different insignia and ribbons. That's also included within logistics. And it's just keeping track of what the squadron has as assets and making sure that the unit commander is made aware of the unit's capabilities with those things. And sometimes equipment will move around between the wing or sometimes even the region, depending on how frequently it's used. And in those cases, the logistics officers should be made aware in the event that equipment is moving between units so that it can be properly tracked. Then there's operations. And operations involves making sure the planes are okay and making sure the vans are okay and that the unit is mission ready when it comes to going out into the field. So the van has to be inspected, and operations also includes like ensuring that the meetings are being conducted at a proper location and sometimes coordinating with the unit commander and the location that they're meeting at to make sure everything is on the same page. It's just making sure that everything is operating. Standardization and evaluation is the group or the specialty track where you make sure that people are meeting the regulations. Emergency services is the search and rescue side of Civil Air Patrol, and it's actually one of the main mission areas. I have talked a little bit about emergency services in my previous video, like one of the introductory videos, and it combines both aircrew and ground. So if you are afraid of heights and you don't want to be in planes, ground team is a good one for you. It's where you are the boots on the ground, you look for missing people there, you might be in a van, you might be just walking as your team, maybe even a line search, but that is the ground team side. And then air crew is typically where you go up with the plane. You have a mission pilot, a mission observer, and a mission scanner. That's typically made up with three people. Sometimes it's just a mission pilot and a mission observer or a mission scanner. Typically they want a mission pilot and a mission observer to go up because of like the instruments that are required to be used and the tracking and the logging. The responsibilities are just greater for the mission observer, and the expectations are higher because you have to do an additional Well, you have to do additional education and training on top of just looking outside of a window, which is what Mission Scanner is. So that's typically why a Mission Observer and Mission Pilot go up together. There's also Airborne Photographer, which is where they take pictures of any damage that might be in like a flooded area, or they might be taking pictures for a client that's looking for photos of some kind of like disaster that happened. In fact, the first pictures taken of 9/11 were from a CAP aircraft, and that was using an airborne photographer. So that's just something to know. So if you are excited about planes and you want to be flown using Air Force funding, hey, go up in the plane. You don't have to pay for it. CAP will pay for your training. So you can do either of those. You can do both of them. I am involved with both. And if you have any more questions about emergency services specifically, feel free to ask them in the comments down below. Let's move on to the next one. Communication. Now, communication involves primarily the radios. Now, there is something called ICUT, which is the introductory communications training. And it teaches people how to use nice handheld radios with the whole like twist in what is that thing called? Antenna! A twist in antenna, and you push the button to talk, and there are certain standards and expectations of using radio. Those are the primary responsibilities of the communications officer, and also keeping track of where the radios might be located. Now, they sometimes work together actively with logistics teams just because radios are an asset for the squadron, so the logistics team and the comms team should both be aware of the location of the radios at all times. Aerospace education is the next one, and that is another main mission of Civil Air Patrol. I have talked about this one in depth in my introductory video, so you should be able to check it out in the iCard, but aerospace education is such a key part of Civil Air Patrol to the point where they have a ton of different badges and a ton of different ways to engage in it. Like, they even have a program for aerospace related educators specifically to get involved within Civil Air Patrol. And there's the model rocketry badge, there's the STEM related badge, there's the cyber badge, and cyber does fall within aerospace education at this time. I personally think it should be an entirely separate thing, and not just something in information technology, but a completely different cyber track, just so that senior members can be involved with it. But that's just my thing. That's not a thing right now. Hopefully it will be sometime in the near future. But aerospace education primarily focuses on those STEM-related careers and getting cadets interested in it. But not just cadets, also just broadening the senior members' experience with understanding aerospace-related concepts, giving them chances to learn more about things that are associated with STEM. Participating in AEX, for example, is another way that aerospace education officers can engage both senior members and cadets. Next one is the Cadet Programs track, which is another main mission of Civil Air Patrol. So remember, there's three: aerospace education, emergency services, and cadet programs. So cadet programs, there's an entire cadet side to Civil Air Patrol, and the cadet program specialty track is just focused on supporting and mentoring the cadets. As a senior rated cadet program specialty track person, I can say that there's a lot of indirect leadership and mentoring involved with cadet programs, and if you have experience with like drill and ceremonies, that can be very helpful. And understanding how to do the feedback sandwich with cadets can be very helpful, and just asking questions in general, because it's a leadership laboratory and it's a place for both cadets and senior members to learn. And being part of a cadet program and supporting that is very important to the success of Civil Air Patrol. It's not the only side of it. It's not nearly all of it, but it plays an important function with Civil Air Patrol because, well, it's training the future leaders of America within the CAP program. So if you don't like working with the cadets, the teenagers, then cadet programs may not necessarily be something you should do. Now, if you're okay with occasionally working with them, any of the specialty tracks should be okay. And sometimes there are just senior member squadrons, which I will talk about in a later video. I'll talk about the different types of squadrons, but there are a lot of instances where you will interact with the cadets, not all the time, but if you're in a larger squadron, you may just interact with senior members exclusively, or occasionally teach the cadets, like a class. Like, if you're a rocket scientist, you could talk about rockets with the cadets, because they don't have that experience. But it honestly depends on how you want to be involved with them, and you kind of have to decide how involved would I like to be with the cadets before, like, choosing the cadet program, specialty track, or teaching their classes in general. Next one is safety. Safety is one of our concerns, and we have a specialty track that allows people who are more safety-oriented to help keep track of safety mishaps, set up safety standards, and ensure that we are conducting ourselves in a safe manner. So there is the ORM process, which is the operational risk management process, where we check to see if the risk outweighs the benefits of doing the activity, and like kind of rating how bad is the risk and the severity and the frequency that we could potentially experience it, and rate it against what the benefits are, and then give an official recommendation to the commander. So for example, if you go to a summer activity and it is 105 degrees outside, it is humid, and the sun is out blazing, it may not be a good idea to be outside all day and do drill and ceremonies training. And it might be better to do some kind of process of learning aerospace related or cyber related careers in one of the lecture halls. And the safety officer would make recommendations to the commander, would file mishaps. So like if someone ran into a pile of bees. Yeah, that sounds weird. If someone tripped and fell into like a little pit somewhere and the pit wasn't marked off, then the safety officer would investigate, file the mishap in e-services, and would maybe mark it off with tape. However, something to keep in mind is if you ever notice something that is unsafe, the phrase that we use is knock it off, and anyone can say it. If anyone says it, then all activities should cease, and you stop, think, is this safe? And you take a step back from whatever it is you're doing to make sure that everyone is okay. Okay, that's just my quick safety tangent. Okay, moving back to the safety officer track, or the safety specialty track. It's important, and there aren't too many responsibilities associated with it on the squadron level other than doing monthly safety briefings and making sure that people are staying safe. But there is definitely a huge need for that when doing wing level or group level activities, just to make sure that it's being filled and that people are being safety oriented and being briefed on a consistent basis so that we are safety oriented. Then there's legal. I'm not going to go into legal. Most people normally don't do the legal. Lawyers would also do well in the legal thing. Health services is making sure that the people stay healthy. So if you are a nurse as a profession or a doctor, then you can always pursue the health services one, where you can help administer first aid to those who might need it. You could also provide first aid training. If you are an official instructor in first aid and certified by some organization to instruct, then you could also do that to serve the squadron, especially since ground team members are required to have updated first aid training, one. And two, just generally speaking, first aid is very important. So by sharing your experience and knowledge, then the squadron will also benefit from that, because people will be more safety-minded or safety-conscious. So that is just something that you could consider. But if you don't have experience with health services, you could always get into it to understand a little bit more on staying healthy and making sure that the people are staying properly hydrated and taking care of themselves in whatever training environment that they are in. The next one is the chaplaincy program, which is the emotional support of the members. And this can also be considered in a religious sense. Some of them are like rabbis or priests, and they serve in the chaplaincy program to provide members with that like support in that sense. So, for example, when I went to encampment a few years ago as like deputy cadet commander for encampment, there was a cadet who was very, very emotionally distressed. And they were basically having an anxiety attack. I helped to calm them down with the chaplain to make sure that we were supporting them, they felt like we were there for them, and if they wanted to discuss what happened afterwards, after they had calmed down, that both of us were available as a resource. And as a chaplain, there is an official chaplaincy program, and I know that one of the national level chaplains, he's a fantastic, very loving and kind individual that really genuinely cares for all. And typically the chaplain might say a quick prayer at the beginning of an activity, or provide religious services for a sleepaway. Like at an encampment, they might do daily services for those who are interested in those. So it's just the chaplaincy program provides those kind of supports for its members. Chaplains can also help with the character development program, which I will be discussing in a little bit. There's the command specialty track, and if you are serving as a commander, then you are doing the specialty track, and you work your way from being a squadron commander to a group commander to a wing commander, and you can even work your way up to regional or national level. But you have to be selected by the Board of Governors to do the whole national thing. So it is a bit of a process, but typically, if you are going for the command specialty track, you have to be interested in serving at the squadron level at least as a squadron commander, and then maybe potentially expanding on from there. Next is historian, and there aren't a lot of historians within CAP, but if you are associated with something with archiving, libraries, history, then this might be cool for you. In fact, like, there is an actual curator for like Civil Air Patrol related history pieces, and he is very nice, he is very awesome, and I've got to meet him a few times. Anyway, he's very cool, and the program is trying to establish a paper trail of kind of like the full history of Civil Air Patrol. It's over 75 years old and has a pretty long legacy. And it's very interesting to kind of see the developments where Civil Air Patrol used to help with World War II and sinking U-boats. Or like how it's progressed to now where we use cellular tracking to be able to find cell phones of missing people and then be able to help the search and rescue teams recover those individuals and save their lives. So if you're interested in history, the history specialty track is available, but not too many people do it, so maybe that is your cup of tea. The next one is the moral leadership / character development, and there are a certain number of hours per month that the cadets are required to be involved with character development, and this is more along the lines of living a respectful lifestyle and being conscious of those around you. So, like, one of the trainings was about humor and understanding how different people have different senses of humor, so we can be respectful of others while using our sense of humor, and just be aware of what we're saying. There's also the wingmen course, where you teach about how we are here for each other, and that's typically for brand new members in Civil Air Patrol, and it has to be a course that's, it doesn't have to be taught by a CDI or a character development instructor, but character development itself has to either be taught by the squadron commander, the chaplain of the squadron, or a character development instructor. So it is an important position because of how frequently it has to brief cadets within the squadron, and because it's kind of teaching cadets emotional responsibility and just being generally a good person. Next one is recruiting intention. It's just bringing the people in and keeping the people in Civil Air Patrol. So recruiting and retention might work actively with public affairs to say, hey, could we tell people about this activity that's coming up? let's look for career fairs that are going on to kind of tell people about the opportunity of Civil Air Patrol. Or maybe let's think of activities that would get people more interested in staying active with the squadron, like spray the spots, where you bring your super soakers to the meeting, and then you spray the recently promoted spots cadet or something. Like, there are a lot of different opportunities that you could make for cadets and senior members alike to get them interested and invested in the squadron through the recruiting and retention specialty track. And the last one is information technology, which has increasingly grown more important. So this would be tracking the laptops, seeing if you have like a squadron hotspot. Typically IT is in charge of that. If people are having issues with their email accounts, most wings have specific email accounts that you have associated with your Civil Air Patrol ID and your name. So if there are issues with that, then the information technology specialty track trains you to be prepared to get involved with that. My wing is actually converting from the Google system to the Microsoft system because of where the cloud storage is stored. It's supposed to be US-based, so Microsoft is what we've been transitioning to. And on a consistent basis, the information technology officer is communicating with us, telling us about the updates that have been made, any changes that we should take under consideration, and just briefing us in general to make sure that everyone is on the same page on how information technology stuff is being run. So this was a long one. We went over all 22 different specialty tracks, and there is an information guide and a pamphlet. I'll call it a pamphlet because that's what it's called in Civil Air Patrol terms, that takes you through everything step by step. And if you aren't really sure what you need to do, then you should talk to your professional development officer. If you don't know who your professional development officer is, you should ask, one. And two, you can always chat with me, redberrywheelbusiness@gmail.com, or in the comments down below, and I'd be more than happy to discuss it with you. And since you're a senior member, you don't necessarily have to CC other people, but if you include someone from your home unit, then I at least will feel better about it, because then people will know that you're reaching out to additional resources. So that's just something to keep in mind. If you do have any questions, please let me know, and I'd be more than happy to address them. So thank you so much for watching, and that is all, folks. Until next time, toodles.